here we are having summary. So we are having summary how to solve problem related with unsymmetrical section. So in unsymmetrical sections, principal axes do not coincide with an unsymmetrical bending. So let me correct it. So unsymmetrical bending of unsymmetrical sections. So as we have seen that in case of unsymmetrical section, we do not know orientation of principal axis, because principal axis will be different from centroidal axis. Just like in case of symmetrical section, we know that centroidal axis, there are the principal axis. But we know that the Fleckier equation is only applicable if the loadings and geometric properties are given with reference to principal axis. So how we can solve the problem pertaining to unsymmetrical section? So it means that we can only solve this problem if we know all geometric properties and loading properties with reference to principal axis. So very first step will be that we need to determine orientation of principal axis. So it means that orientation of principal axis we can determine by knowing geometric properties with reference to centroidal axis or given reference axis. So very first step is that if we are given any unsymmetrical section, so first of all we need to determine the centroidal location or centroidal axis. So we will determine the centroidal axis and we will plot the centroidal axis by knowing the centroidal location x bar and y bar, and then we will compute second moment of areas and product moment of area about our centroidal axis or given reference axis. So why we are using reference axis as a centroidal axis? Because it is easy to determine centroidal location and second moment of areas with reference to centroidal axis, because we expressions are readily available. Then next step will be that we will determine orientation of principal axis, and orientation of principal axis will be determined by this expression. So in this expression, we are having negative sign here. So it means that if all values Ixy, Ix and Iy, they are positive, then theta p will be negative. Negative means a clockwise direction with reference to our centroidal axis. So in some cases, we may have product moment of inertia negative and Ix may be more than Iy. So if product moment of inertia that may be negative, then this negative sign will be multiplied with this negative. So theta p may be positive. Positive means that in clockwise direction. In some cases, Ixy may be positive, but Iy value may be more than Ix. If Iy value is more than Ix, in that case, theta p may also be positive, even though Ixy is positive also. So then what we will do after determining the orientation of principal axis, what we will do, we will determine geometric properties like Ix bar and Iy bar with reference to principal axis. How we can determine? By using any one of set of equation out of three. Out of three, we can use any set of equation. So this equation, this set of equation, this and this, these equations are only applicable or give Ix bar and Iy bar value about principal axis. This equation, this one and this one. And this equation, this is not theta sensitive. So this equation can give second moment of area Ix bar, Iy bar about any axis which is having orientation theta with reference to, with respect to our reference axis. So here this theta will be theta p. So this equation is theta specific. It means that this equation is only applicable if theta will be equal to theta p. If you want to transform Ix and Iy value about any other theta value, so this expression will give the wrong answer, because these two expression, this and this set of equation, we have derived by substituting theta value equal to theta p. But this equation can be used to transform second moment of area about any reference axis which are having any particular orientation. So if theta p is 30 degree, it means that this equation is only applicable for 30 degree. And this equation only gives answer of Ix bar and Iy bar with reference to principal axis. But this equation may be applicable to give Ix bar and Iy bar along any reference axis or along any variable theta value, maybe 10 degree, 20, 30, 40. So we can transform or transfer second moment of inertia from our reference axis, which are x and y, to any other axis. So how we can implement, can use this equation? So for example, in quiz, if it is asked to determine second moment of area about principal axis, and you are not given the theta value, you are only given product moment of inertia and second moment of area. So you can directly use this equation, and you can also use this equation. But if you want to use this equation or this equation, maybe you need to determine theta p value first. But anyhow, if you want to determine second moment of areas Ix and Iy about principal axis, so all three equations, they will give same answer. Then what we will do? We will determine, or you will determine, the orientation of load with reference to principal axis. And I am referring inclination of load with reference to principal axis as a alpha. So actually we are using three angles. So one is alpha, one is theta, and one is beta. Beta is orientation of neutral axis. Just to differentiate all three type of angle, you can use any notation. So theta is referred as orientation of principal axis with reference to our central axis. Alpha will be regarded inclination or orientation of load, that may be movement, that may be point load, applied load with reference to principal axis. And beta, we shall use the beta notation to describe orientation of neutral axis. So we will determine orientation of load with reference to principal axis, because we have already determined the orientation of principal axis. Then what we will do, we will resolve the load along principal axis so that we can determine movement about principal axis. And we want to use the principle of superposition to determine the resultant stresses. And then if we want to determine stress at any particular point, so the coordinate of that point should also be determined with reference to principal axis. So we need to put coordinate x bar and also y bar with reference to, or with respect to, principal axis. Then we can use Fletcher formula and principle of superposition to determine resultant stress. Principle of superposition means we can determine stresses due to mx moment separately, and we can determine stresses induced by my moment separately at the same point, and then we can add them to determine resultant stresses, just like we have resolved the problem for symmetrical section. So here in this slide, it will give you the idea how we can transform the coordinate of a given point from centroidal axis to principal axis. So this case we have already discussed. So we may have these two cases. So if you are having this case for this Z section, which is basically an unsymmetrical section, I want to determine stress at point A. So it means that in Fletcher equation, I should have coordinate of point A with reference to principal axis. I am considering x bar as a principal axis and y bar also principal axis, which are oriented at an angle theta in clockwise section. So theta is positive. For this z section, product moment of inertia is negative. How it will be negative? We shall discuss in one of problem that we are solving today. So we are only given the coordinate of this point YA with reference to our central axis X, and we know XA. XA is a distance from this Y axis to this point A with reference to our central axis. So this is XA. So if we know XA value and YA value, that we can easily determine if we know the centroidal location. So we can determine y bar a and x bar a with reference to principal axis by using this expression. So this expression we have already derived. So how to memorize? If you want to determine y component, so y cos theta. So first function will also be the cos function of same point with reference to same axis minus x sin theta. And x bar will be equal to x a cos theta plus y a sin theta. So these two expressions we have already derived, where y is equal to y cos theta and x is equal to x cos theta plus y sin theta. So this we have already derived here. Transformation of coordinate if the theta is positive. Positive means counterclockwise direction. So y bar is equal to y cos theta minus x sin theta, and x bar is equal to x cos theta plus y sin theta. So these expression, equation 1 and 2, they are applicable if theta is positive, mean counterclockwise side. But if the theta is negative, orientation of principal axis is negative clockwise, then how we can transform the coordinate by using this equation? So in this equation, this is a mirror image. This section Z is the mirror image of this Z. So for this Z section, product moment of inertia will be positive. So that's why we are having negative theta, or theta is oriented in clockwise direction. So here you can see that X bar axis, our reference axis is X. So x bar axis is oriented in counterclockwise direction. So here x bar axis is oriented in clockwise direction because theta is negative. So what you can do in this equation, if you are substituting the theta value minus in the same expression, so cos minus theta is equal to cos theta. But if you substitute in the same equation theta value minus, so x sine minus theta is equal to sine minus sine theta. So minus sine theta will be 1 minus n will be multiplied with this minus, so it will be positive. So similarly, cos minus theta is equal to cos theta, and sine minus theta is equal to minus sine theta, so we are having this sign. So you can just memorize this equation. So if that for positive theta, if theta is negative, then the sign will be reversed. Y bar is equal to y cos theta plus x sin theta, and x bar will be equal to x cos theta minus y sin theta. Just memorize this expression for theta positive, theta p positive. If theta will be negative, then this sign will be reversed. So we know the coordinate with reference to y, with reference to x bar, x and y axis, centroidal axis. So theta value we can substitute positive, and then we can determine coordinate with reference to principal axis. For example, we can determine x bar a and y bar a by using this simple expression. So okay, I will discuss this slide later. Actually, if we want to determine deflection just like we have discussed in the previous case. So deflection along y axis, about x bar, is the function of the load which is acting about along y bar, and deflection along x axis is the function of the load which is acting along x bar axis. So we need to use the moment of inertia accordingly. So I will discuss this slide later on, how we can use this slide. So we can directly determine resultant deflection if we know a moment of inertia about neutral axis by using resultant load. So let me discuss, because you will not be able to understand at the moment. Okay, now we are going to solve example number 3, which is related with unsymmetrical bending of unsymmetrical section. So what is the given information or the data? We are given this angle section. The shorter leg is having dimension 100 mm. Longer leg is having dimension 200 mm. And the thickness of angle section is 20 mm. And it is being used as a cantilever beam. And the length of the beam is 3 meters. And with 200 mm leg is in vertical direction. So this cantilever beam is having length 3 meter and it supports a load of 6 kN at free end. So a cantilever beam, so a load is acting at a free tip. So if you want me to sketch, so let me quickly sketch it. So you can say that we are having maybe a cantilever beam. So let me change the color a bit. And it is subjected to a load at free tip. So it is subjected to a load of 6 kN at free end tip. So if this beam will deflect, so you can say that it will so because in case of cantilever beam, so the beam will deflect like this way. So it means that when it will deflect like this way, so tension will be on the top surface, or on the loading side there will be tension, and opposite to the load the bottom surface will be subjected to compression, just to make you understand. So what we need to do, we need to determine maximum bending stress in the beam, We do not know, but at the moment I will determine the stress at all corner points. So whichever the point will have the maximum stresses will be the point which is subjected to maximum stress. Orientation of neutral axis and maximum deflection, and also plot the stress profile. Okay, in many books, the load is given that it is acting in the center of this vertical leg, or it is passing through the intersection of this two leg, this center point, which is the correct point location. But you do not know that in some cases the biaxial bending will occur if the load is acting an axis which is parallel to principal axis. To make the case simple, because we haven't discussed the problem of shear center, so you may just consider that load is passing through the centroidal axis. But actually, load should pass through the center of this vertical leg, center line, where the center line of these two vertical legs are intersecting at this center. But to make the case easier at the moment, so we are assuming that the load is passing through centroid. Okay, here in this case, you will see that even though the load is passing or acting along centroidal axis, but they will create biaxial bending or unsymmetrical bending. Why? Because we are dealing with unsymmetrical section. Angle section is unsymmetrical about both x and y axis. So it means that these centroidal axes, they will not be principal axes. Or in other words, the load is not passing through principal axis, so it will create biaxial bending. So how we can solve this problem? So we can solve this problem by using principal superposition about principal axis. So it means that first of all, we need to determine the orientation of principal axis. In order to determine the orientation of principal axis, we should know what are the centroidal location. Because if we know the centroidal location, and if then we can determine the moment of inertia about centroidal axis, then we can transform the moment of inertia from centroidal axis to principal axis. So the very first step is determination of centroidal axis. So this is our angle section. So what we can do, we can split up into two parts. Area number one, so how we can split up? So we can split up into two area. And let's suppose one will be this, and let me increase the transparency. So one will be this area and other area will be, just to make you understand, and one will be this area, and let me represent with different color, maybe this one. Yes, so I have subdivided this area into two area. This will be the area one and this will be area two. I'm solving the problem by part. So we can take a moment, the first moment of area, static moment of area about this point E or about this axis. So x bar can be determined by area 1. So area 1, sorry, maybe 200. So let me check if there are some mistake. Okay, let me discuss it again. So this first area, if I want to taking the moment about this vertical axis, yes, about this axis. So this area will be equal to 200 into 20, 20 into 200, and I'm taking the moment about this axis or about this. So what is the x centroidal location of this area? So centroidal location of this area will be half, x1 will be half of this 20. So center will be somewhere here. So here we are having 10. If I consider this area, the area of this rectangle will be 20 into 80, because total is 100. So if I subtract this 20, so this width will be 80. So 80 into 20 will be area. And the centroidal location of this area, 80, from this point will be 40. So 100 minus 40 will be 60. So centroidal location of this area with reference to this vertical axis will be 60 divided by A1 over A2. So this value, actually this supposed to be 80. Let me correct. No, I cannot correct here. So I will send you the corrected slide. So this supposed to be 100 into 200 plus 80 into 20. So I cannot modify the moment, but this is 80. So by mistake, I have written 180. So X bar location will be 24.3. So 24.3, I have determined this centroidal location. And if this is 24.3, then distance from this vertical axis to this point will be 75.7, 100 minus 24.3. Similarly, we can determine centroidal location along Y direction by using this formula. So area will be same. Again, I am having a mistake. So that's supposed to be 200 into 20. And its centroidal location should be 100. So this answer, okay, now here. So I will correct this. Anyhow, maybe I have written the wrong expression. So actually this will be supposed to be the area one. So area one will be supposed to 20 into 200 into 20, and then Y bar location should be 100. So this value should be 100. And then this area should be 80 into 20, and then its Y bar location from this point should be 10. And then this is the corrected value is written. If you are determining this value, that will be 74.3. So the centroidal location Y bar will be from this point E with reference point will be 74.3. So centroidal location with reference to other top surface will be 125.7, 200 minus 74.3. Okay, second is very important, determination of product moment of inertia. So product moment of inertia, again, I don't know where they have come from, but I guess actually I have written the properties with reference to this section, but I'm unable to modify at the moment because MathCAD is not installed. This answer is written correctly, but IXY, but I will explain. The slide that I will send you will have the correct value substituted here. So A1 is equal to, actually that's supposed to be, okay, here, I consider this may be area A1, maybe 100 into 20. Okay, so actually, in this equation, when you are determining product moment of inertia, so you are considering this area and this area. So it means that what I want to explain. So if I insert one more point, this is the centroid of this area 1, and this is the centroid of this area 2. So if you see that this area 1, why this is 0.5 is coming, yes, okay, so you will see that centroid of this area 1, it is situated in second quadrant. So it means that the second quadrant, you need to determine the centroidal location of this area 1 with reference to this centroidal axis. So it means that x quadrant of this area will be negative, but the y coordinate of this centroidal point with reference to centroidal axis will be positive. So how we can determine? Maybe this might be correct. So you can easily determine, for example, this total area is equal to, total length is equal to 200. So what you can do, you can subtract 100 from 125.7. So you will have 25.7, this answer. Because this centroidal point, it is situated at a distance of 100 from both point, point F or point E. So distance from here to here is 125.7. If you will subtract this 100 from here to here, so you will have distance from this center to this point, so which will be 25.7. So in the same way, the distance, so actually this is the this area, so by mistake it is written over here. So if you want to write down its x coordinate, so x coordinate will be distance from here to here is 24.3, and the centroidal location is 10 millimeter from this point F. So it means that 24.3 minus 10 will be the x coordinate of this area from this center to this vertical axis, which will be minus 14.3. So they have been written reverse, but I will correct it. Similarly, for this centroidal location, from this bottom will be 10 because total thickness is 20. So 74.3 minus 10 will be 64.3, so which is written over here. So by mistake, I have written on the opposite side. So by this way, you can write down their coordinate. So this point, centroid of this area 2, is situated in fourth coordinate. So it means that both x and y coordinate of this area or this area 2 will be negative. So in this way, the product moment of inertia may be negative or positive. But actually, in second moment of area, if any one coordinate is negative, so if we are taking the square, so that will automatically will become positive. So second moment of area will always be positive. For example, if you can say that this 20 is negative, so if you are taking the cube of this negative and if you multiplying with the further minus negative of 100, so that will become positive. So second moment of area will always be positive. So product moment of inertia of this angle section is minus 5.14 into exponent 6, which is correctly written, but in this expression values are wrongly quoted, but I will correct it. So second moment of area, so we will also determine by part. So moment of inertia of this area is equal to 100. So actually this supposed to be, also the values are misquoted. So this should be 200, this value. 20 into 200 cube divided by 12 into, okay, so now first this area is mentioned. So actually, maybe I have considered this area as a half and this as a full. So 20 into 180 cube, because he considered this part until here. Moment of inertia of this rectangle about its centroid. Then by parallel axis theorem, we need to transfer the moment of inertia of this area from its centroid to our centroidal axis. So area of this rectangular will be 20 into 80, and 37.5 is the distance from the centroid of this area to the this x-axis of this area to the x-axis of our centroidal x-axis, which is 37.5. Similarly, you can transfer the moment of inertia from centroid of this rectangular to the centroidal our centroidal axis. So 100 into 20 cube, and then difference between x-axis of rectangular 2 to the x-axis where we want to transfer moment of inertia, and that distance will be equal to 74.3 minus 10, which is 64.3. So this is correct expression. Similarly, IY, moment of inertia, we need to transfer from centroidal axis of rectangular 1 and rectangular 2 to the centroidal axis, our resultant y-axis. So if we want to take moment of inertia about y-axis, so it will be this area. So now our B will be 20 and D will be 100. BD cube divided by 12, area. And then this location distance is 75.7, and this centroidal location is 50 from this side. So 75.7 minus 50, the answer will be 25.7. And in the same way, we are having moment of inertia of this rectangular, 180 into 20 cube, B is this one, D is 20 cube. And we want to transfer from y-axis, from the centroidal y-axis of area 1 to the resultant y-axis. So this distance will be 14.3. 24.3 minus 10. So we will have moment of inertia about centroidal x-axis 22.68 and centroidal y-axis 3.84. So these values are correctly written, but I will correct some of mistake over here. So we are having geometric properties or second moment of areas with reference to our centroidal axis. So Ix, y value, and Ix and Iy, they are given. So second moment of area, Ix and Iy, they will always be positive. But product moment of inertia may be negative or positive depending upon our type of section. Okay, second step. Now we can transform the geometric properties about principal axis. But first of all, we need to determine orientation of principal axis. So theta p, we have already derived this expression, that is minus half tangent inverse into 2 ixy over ix minus iy. So in this equation, our reference axis is x-axis. If the first value here is x, then it means that theta will be given from x. You can use also Iy minus Ix. If you are using Iy minus Ix, then theta p will be with reference to y-axis. But if you are using the same expression, it means that our reference axis is the x-axis. So in this equation, substitute the values of our product moment of inertia minus 5.14 into exponent 6. Ix is 22.68, Iy 3.84. So from this expression, because product moment of inertia is a negative and Ix is more than Iy, so this minus sign will be multiplied with minus here, so theta p will be positive. So it means that our x bar axis will be oriented in counterclockwise direction from centroidal x axis. So this x principal axis will be oriented at 14.31 degree from our x axis. So y bar axis will be perpendicular to this x axis. So this theta and this theta value will be same. So in this case, we have determined the orientation of principal axis. Okay, next step is we will transform second moment of inertias or areas from centroidal axis to principal axis. So you can use any one set of equation out of these three. You can either determine by using this expression, this or this. I have used this expression, but if you want, you can use this expression. Or if you want, you can determine Ix bar, Iy bar by using this formula. So any one of set of equation can be used. So I have used this equation. So Ix plus Iy, I have taken exponent 6 as a common outside, divided by 2, plus and minus Ix minus Iy. So this is also mistake. This is supposed to be minus. I will correct it into cos 2 theta. So cos 2 theta, theta value we have determined as 14.31. Okay, please note that if this theta is negative, then you need to substitute this value with negative sign here. Since in our case theta is positive, so we are inputting this theta value as a positive. But if this theta is a negative, then you need to substitute theta value with negative sign. Plus minus product moment of inertia, which is minus 5.14 into exponent 6 into sine 2 theta p. So if you are solving this equation with top sign plus and minus sign, you will have the value 24 into exponent 6. And instead of positive, if you want to use this sign negative and this sign positive, so you shall have answer for second moment of area about y principal axis. So there is a quick check. I have told you that the summation of second moment of areas about any axis will be same. So about x-axis, centroidal axis, Ix was 22.68 plus 3.84 was the Iy. If you want to compute this mission, so this mission will be same as of the sum of Ix bar and Iy bar. There might be some insignificant rounding error. So it means that if you know Ix bar value, then you can determine Iy bar value by subtracting Ix bar from the summation of Ix plus Iy. So you can also determine. This is a check that summation of second moment of area is always constant about any reference axis. But they may have their value minimum and maximum. So Ix value, it is maximum about this x bar axis principal axis, which is oriented 14.31. And Iy, it is having its minimum value 2.53, only about y axis. It means that about any other axis, Ix bar value will always be less than 24, and about any other y axis which is having any arbitrary angle theta, Iy bar value may be more than 2.53, but the summation will be same. So this is the maximum possible value of Ix bar, which is only possible about principal axis, and this is maximum possible value of Iy bar, which is only about the y principal axis. About any other axis, Iy bar value will be more than 2.53 and Ix bar value will be less than 24. But summation will be same. For example, you will see that Ix axis is not a principal axis. So Ix value is 22.68, which is less than 24. So 24 is the maximum possible value. And about y axis, so moment of inertia about y axis is 3.84, which is more than this value 2.53. So it means that 2.53 is the minimum possible value, which is only applicable about principal axis. About any other axis, Iy bar value will be more than 2.53 and Ix bar value will be less than 24, but their summation will be same. Okay, now we need to transform our loading with reference to principal axis. So you can use any one concept, either using the load concept or movement concept. So in our given problem, load is acting in downward direction. at free end, which is passing through the centroidal axis. But if you show orientation of principal axis along with centroidal axis, this load is not acting along principal axis or any one of the principal axis. It means that this load will cause unsymmetrical bending and flexure formula will not be applicable. Flexure formula is only applicable if load is acting along or parallel to one of the principal axis, or if the moment they are acting about one of the principal axis. So since this load is not acting or passing through or acting parallel to or along principal axis, but it is acting along centroidal axis, so it means that this will cause unsymmetrical bending. So you are having two concepts. You can resolve this load into two components, and each of the load component is acting along one of principal axis. So if this theta is 14.31, the angle between x bar and x is 14.31 theta, same will be the angle between y bar and y axis. So it means that we know the orientation of load with reference to our principal axis. So you can resolve this load into two components. So this is the concept of the solution by using the concept of load. So if I resolve this load into two components and each of the component is acting one of the principal axis, then the component of the load which is acting along y bar axis will be py bar. And this component will be cos function of this p. Why? Because theta is given from y-axis. So the base y-bar will become the base, or component along y-bar will be cos function of load. Similarly, the component of the load which is acting along x-bar axis will be referred as a px-bar, and that will be the sine function of this theta p. So px-bar will be equal to p sine theta. So you can use this concept. This is a load concept, resolution or resolving the load along principal axis. You can also use the concept of moment if you want. So you can, you may only use or refer only one of the concept in the examination or during your solution. But I have explained both. Okay, I told you that if the load is acting along y-axis, resultant load, then movement will always be produced about axis which is perpendicular to the load axis. So it means that this load will produce net movement or resultant movement about this x-axis. So this, if you can, we can replace this load by its equivalent movement m, and movement is shown by a double-headed vector. So it means that the movement vector will be along this x-axis if the load is acting along vertical axis, but we do not know whether this vector will be oriented on right side or left side. So we can use the concept of right hand rule. So right hand rule means that we need to place our finger in compression side and wrist on the tension side, then the thumb direction will be the movement vector. So in cantilever beam, so it means that the loading side will be in tension, and opposite to the load there must be compression, because if the load is acting downward direction, so top side will be in tension and bottom side will be in compression. So opposite to the load we will have compression, and in the loading side we will have tension. So it means that if the load is acting in downward side, so the axis about which the movement is acting will be the neutral axis, for instance. So one side of the movement will be subjected to tension and one side will be compression. So in cantilever case, load is this one. So above this centroidal axis, we will have tension, and below this centroidal axis, we will have compression. So finger should be placed in compression side, then our thumb will be directing toward the movement vector. So it means that we can replace this load by this movement vector. So if we are dealing with the movement vector, so you can say that this is the coordinate one, second quadrant, third quadrant and fourth quadrant with reference to principal axis. So this movement is not acting along, sorry, about one of the principal axis, x bar or y bar, rather at certain inclination theta, which is 14.31. So you can resolve this movement into two components. One component is acting along x. So if the vector is acting away from this region, so for mx component, vector will also be acting away. So the angle is given, you can assume this as a base. So the component of movement which is acting along x bar will be mx bar, and it will be the cos function of this movement. So it will be equal to m cos theta p. And similarly, the component of load which is acting along y or about y principal axis will be my bar, and that will be sine function of resultant movement because angle is given from x bar axis. So you can determine movement by any of concept, answer will be same. So by using the concept, you can solve the solution. So why I have shown here. So in case of cantilever beam, because if load is acting at free end, so the maximum moment will be at this point. So P into L will be the maximum moment which is acting at fixed end. So maximum moment will be P into L. If you want to determine MX bar, so MX bar will be the moment. So movement about x axis will be produced by the load which is acting along y bar. So Py into L will be equal to mx bar. 6 cos 14.3 into 3 is the length. So movement will be 17.44 kilonewton into meter. And similarly, my bar will be equal to Px bar into L, because movement about y axis will be produced by due to load which is acting along x bar axis. So movement will be produced in perpendicular direction to the load axis. So my bar will be 4.441. Or what you can do, you can determine resultant movement. So when you are determining the component of the movement along x and y by using this equation, answer will be same. Okay, next is, we can determine this mx bar and my bar, ix bar value, because that value will be constant. Actually, we are supposed to use this equation. So if we want to determine the stress at any point, for example, this corner point A, B, C, D. So for all these points, my bar over iy bar value and mx bar over ix bar value will be constant. We just need to substitute their respect x bar and y bar value with reference to our point under consideration. So I am determining this factor, which will be the main constant, separately. So mx bar over ix bar value, so movement is 17.44, this is supposed to be. So this is in kilonewton into meter. So if I want to convert into newton and millimeter, we need to multiply with exponent 6, and ix bar value we have determined 24 into exponent 6. So mx bar over ix bar will be 0.727 newton per millimeter cube. Similarly, my bar over iy bar, 4.44 into exponent 6 divided by 2.53 into exponent 6. So we may have the answer 1.755 newton per millimeter. So next is, we can determine orientation of principal axis, beta bar. Actually, all values must be with reference to with reference to principal axis. For example, here, when we determine the beta value by this equation, so in this equation, so all parameters must be with reference to principal axis. I x bar, I y bar, and this theta, all value must be with reference to principal axis. So we derived this equation actually from here. So I x bar over I y bar into p cos theta m x over m y. So actually this expression is m y over m x. So I'm using the same equation. You can write here tangent theta also if you want. So you can also write this value as a tangent theta. So answer will be remain same. So minus, so I'm having beta bar because all values will be with reference to principal axis. You need to substitute all values in this equation with reference to principal axis, not with reference to central axis. My bar 4.44 and x bar 17.44. And I believe that you can also write this value as a tangent theta also. I believe the answer will be same whatever we are having this. So I x bar value and I y bar answer, values you need to substitute from here. So answer is coming out to be -67.51. So minus sign indicate that beta is in clockwise direction from our x bar axis, beta bar. So it means that beta value is from in clockwise direction. I'm going to explain two way from x bar axis. So when we are solving the problem with reference to principal axis, we will forget our centroidal axis. Now I will say that beta value will be from our x principal axis in clockwise direction and angle will be 67.51. So all values will be with reference to principal axis. So on this diagram, I have shown this principal axis. I have also shown the centroidal, but if you want, you can only show principal axis. So beta will be from our x bar axis in clockwise direction, and this angle will be 67.51. Or whatever I said, theta and beta, principal axis, theta for moment vector, and beta will be from same axis. So this is resultant moment. So moment vector is given from this x axis. So beta will also be from the same axis. So both they are true. So orientation of neutral axis, you need to show orientation of neutral axis on a neat sketch, just like I have shown here. So neutral axis will be in clockwise direction from our x principal axis, which is 67.51. So we can simplify our Flexure equation. In this Flexure equation again, all values will be with reference to principal axis, and we need to substitute the value my bar, mx bar, I y bar, x bar, and coordinate of any point under consideration with reference to principal axis. So all values my bar, x bar, I y bar, mx bar, I y bar, and ix, they will be positive. So but we need to substitute this sign, positive or negative, with reference to tension or compression. So here this z indicate that the stress they are acting along the longitudinal axis. These are not with reference to any point, just I have shown. So if you substitute the value my bar over I y bar, because I have already computed 7.727, and mx bar, so they are reciprocated, change. Okay, no. Mx bar over Ix bar 0.727, this value. And I'm bringing this parameter to this side, so this will be y. and I am y bar over I y bar 1.755 into x. So this will be my resultant equation. So if I want to determine stress at point this one, so I need to substitute y coordinate and x coordinate of this point with reference to principal axis, and that coordinate I can determine by using this transformation equation that we have already derived. So since theta p is positive, so we shall use this equation. So in this equation, y bar is equal to y cos theta minus x sin theta, and x bar coordinate will be x cos theta plus y sin theta because theta is positive, just like I have explained over here. So let's suppose I want to determine stress at all corner point A, B, C, D, E and F. So I'm using this equation. So in this equation, you need to substitute x and y coordinate of any point with its coordinate sign. For example, point A, it is situated at, it is lying in the second quadrant. So distance from y-axis will be 24.3 minus 20 will be minus 4.3. Similarly, x coordinate of point B will also be same, minus 4.3. But x coordinate of point F and E both will be situated at the same x distance from this point y-axis. So x coordinate of this point F will be minus 24.3. And this is in the second quadrant. So X value will be minus 24.3. Similarly for point E, it is in the fourth quadrant. So X coordinate of this point will also be negative minus 24.3. Y coordinate, because point A and F both are in lying in second quadrant, so both are situated at a same distance from x-axis. So the y coordinate of F and A are 125.7 positive. So just say A, y value for A point is, or y A is 125.7, and y F is also 125.7. Point B and C, they are situated at same y distance from x, which is distance from here to here is 74.3, and this thickness is 20, 74.3 minus 20. So they are in the downward side, so the answer will be 54.3, minus 54.3. So YB is minus 54.3 and YC is also minus 54.3. I will also correct this. Point D and E, they are below the x-axis, so they are also situated at the same y distance from x, and their coordinate will be, y coordinate will be minus 74.3 here. So if you are substituting, you know the coordinate of all point A, F, B, C, D and E point with reference to their central axis, you can substitute this value into this transformation equation to determine x bar value and y bar value. So I didn't compute this value, you may compute yourself, but I have explained here. Y a bar is computed as a y cos theta, y 125.7 into cos theta minus x sin theta. So this x is negative, then you need to substitute this value with its negative sign. And then x a bar, it will be equal to x cos theta plus y sin theta. Since x a is negative, so I have substituted this value with its negative sign. So at the end, by using this equation, you will have x bar and y coordinate, y bar coordinate, or coordinate of point A, B, C, D, E, F with reference to principal axis. So these coordinates may have negative or positive sign with them. This negative or positive sign, they are just indicating the coordinate of any point with reference to principal axis. For example, point D. Point D with reference to principal axis is in lying in the fourth coordinate. In the fourth coordinate, x value is supposed to be positive and y value is negative. So here you can see. So x value is positive and y value negative. Point E is in the third coordinate. So both x and y bar value will be negative. For just check out YE. So this value also supposed to be negative. But anyhow, we only need this value with positive sign, absolute value. Because in this formula, when we are using this Fleischer equation, we will substitute all value my, I, xy, x bar, y bar, mx bar, and ix bar. All value will be positive, even though in this equation they are negative. But we will substitute their absolute value. And we will use this sign, fact tension, or we will pick this sign for both factors or the stress component due to mx and my from our sign convention. So we want to determine stress at point A, B, C, D, E, and F. So this parameter 0.727 and 1.755, just like we have, it will be constant. So if I want to determine the stress at point A, so x bar is 26.97. Just see, 26 point, it should be 26.97. And x value will be, y bar will be 122.85. So point A, so you can pick sign convention either by the load concept or moment concept. If load is acting along y bar axis, then movement will be produced about x bar axis. It means that our x bar axis will become the neutral axis. So it means that movement is produced about principal axis. So one side of neutral axis will be in tension and one side will be in compression. So how we can pick which side is in tension and which side is in compression? So in loading side, all point on the loading side will be subjected to tension in case of cantilever beam. So point F and A are on the above side of this neutral axis, so they are undergoing tension. And all points which are lying below this neutral axis, because movement is produced about x bar, they will undergo compression. So point B, C, D, and E, they will have negative sign. You can also pick sign convention from this movement vector, because if the load is acting along y-axis, so movement is produced along x-axis. So if you know resultant movement is acting this way, so mx component is acting along this side. So you can place your thumb in direction, right thumb of your right hand in vector direction. So finger side, they will represent the compression side and the wrist side is tension. So it means that the axis about which the movement is produced become neutral axis. So this side of the neutral axis will undergo compression and all the fiber or point above this neutral axis will subject it to tension. So this is the neutral axis if only mx bar is acting. So we are dealing only mx bar separately. So because we are using principle of superposition. So if load is acting along x-axis, so it will produce movement about y-axis. It means that our y-axis will become neutral axis. So all fiber on bottom side or opposite side of the load to the neutral axis will undergo compression in case of cantilever. And all fiber which are on right side or one side or the loading side will subject to tension. So point F, A, D and C, they are acting or they are situated on this side. You can say right side or top side, so they will undergo tension. And point all fiber which are on bottom side of this neutral axis will undergo compression. This is only cantilever case. Okay. The second way is that the movement vector MY is acting away. If you are placing your thumb direction along movement vector direction, so axis about which the movement is acting will behave as a neutral axis. So finger direction will be compression and the wrist direction will be in tension. So it means that all fiber which are on this side or bottom side of neutral axis will have negative sign. So it means that the first component are due to MX and second components, they are due to MY. So point A, it is having tension due to MX. Point B, C, D, E, all are having negative sign due to MX. And point F, it will have positive sign. Similarly, point B and E, they will have compression due to MY. Only point B and E, they are having negative sign. And all other points, they are undergoing tension due to MY. So here, you need to substitute their X, YC and XC with positive sign, even though you are having negative value. So negative and positive value, they are just representing coordinate. So in this equation, I told you that all parameters will be positive. You need to substitute positive and pick this sign value, this positive, positive or negative value, depending upon whether the point is subjected to tensile stresses or compressive stresses based upon this diagram. So after that, this is the last slide that I will discuss today. So you need to plot the distribution of the stresses along periphery. So first, I want to sketch the stress profile along point E and F, along how the stress they vary along this surface E and F. Point E is having the stress -121.6. So I have shown point E, this is my reference axis. So on left side, stresses are negative. And point F, 104.84. So this value is 104.84. I have sketched this value. So I will join this point to this point. It means that stress, they are changing from 104.8 from this point F. They are decreasing to zero at certain point here, and then they are changing to the compression. So this is how the stress they varies along this surface. Similarly, if I want to sketch distribution of stresses along point E and D, so at point E, I am having stresses 121.6, but I need to check what are stresses at point D. At point D, I am having positive 30.53. So this stress component I will show on the upper side. So when you are sketching, this coordinate should be proportionate. So if I'm joining this point to this point, so it means that the stress, they are varying from maximum compression to maximum tension on this side. So it means that stresses, they vary from point E to D here. So it means that along this surface, at this point, the stresses are zero. So if I draw a reference line, a perpendicular line, so it means that this is the point on this surface where the stresses are zero. Similarly, at this point, the stresses are zero. So these stresses are zero. If I sketch a reference horizontal line, so this point is here, this one. So at this point, the stresses are zero because I have plotted the stress distribution along this surface. Similarly, I have plotted the stress distribution along this surface. So if I join this point and this point by a line, then a line which is passing through two points where the stresses are zero, this line will be regarded as a neutral axis because this line is passing through two points where the stress are zero. So here, by graphical method, I can also determine orientation of neutral axis. If you are sketching this stress profile on a proper scale, and if you will join these two points, and if you want to measure its orientation with reference to principal axis, so this orientation will be exactly 67.55. So further, we can also plot the stress distribution along this surface. So at point F, stresses are 104.8. At point A, stresses are 136.64. It means that when I'm moving from F to A, so stress they are increasing from 104.8 to 136.4. Then from point F to A, I will come down to point B. What are the stresses at point B? At B, the stresses are maybe minus 68.4. So these are minus 68.4. So it means that I'm here, the stresses are suddenly changing from positive to negative. Then I'm moving from point B to C. So what are the stresses at point C? 53.33. So here the stress is 53.33. So I will plot this stress 53.3 here, mark the point, I will join this. So this is the stress profile along point F to C. Similarly, I can plot the stress distribution along this surface from F to B, C and D. What are the stresses at point A? So at A, the stresses are 136.64. Then from I'm moving downward, first I will encounter point B. What are stresses at point B? Minus 68.4. So stress are changing from positive to minus 68.4. I'm coming down. Then I will go point C. What are the stresses at point C? 53.3. Then from B to C along the same axis, stresses they are changing from minus 68.4 to 53.3 at point C. And what are stresses at point D? 30.53. So this ordinate will be 30.53. I will join this. So this is the distribution of stress along periphery. So next time I will explain the computation of deflection and we will further discuss this question. And I will also going to answer your question regarding understanding of this problem in my upcoming lecture. So if you are having any quick